Got it. Very nice. Tov, you know, I got a text from someone that maybe the topic should be here, questions about the purpose of life. Is that good or it's... Yeah? Okay, so purpose of life, there's a general purpose for all people. Then you have a specific purpose for men and specific purpose for women. Of course, there's differences between Jews and non-Jews, but we focus on the Jews right now. So basically, the main question is the purpose of the Jewish woman in life, especially when she's young, before she got married. This is the years when you're 16, 17, 18, until you get married. What is really the purpose of your life right now? So in order for you to understand, first we start from day one. A Jewish girl comes to the world. She's born. Hashem decides to put the neshama in a female body. It could have been that this neshama was already in a male body in previous life. So the neshama was in a male body for following the mitzvot of the men. Learning Torah, putting tzitzit, tefillin, all these things that specifically is only for men. A person finishes tikkun as a man, now he comes back as a woman. Could have been one time he's a Kohen, then one time he's a Levi. It's all reincarnations. We've been here a few times in the past. Now you are now in the body of a woman. You come to the world and you have a purpose. What's the general purpose of the Jewish woman? We can go over the list. First, coming to the world, that means you got another chance to pass a test. The world is a test. The Torah says, "Ki menaseh Hashem etchem," I'm testing you. Every second of your life, you're in a test. And I'm strict with you. I'm sometimes even torturing you. Why is it that I should first check if you're faithful to me, you keep my mitzvot? And the purpose of this test is because I'm going to reward you in your end. La'atifcha ba'acharitecha. When you die, the reward will begin. Or the punishment, depend what it is. If a person does what Hashem expects him to do, he's going to get rewarded. If a person rebels against his creator, purposely, we'll start with that. Purposely is subject to severe punishment. Out of ignorance, meaning not knowing he's a Jew, or maybe he's aware he's a Jew, but he doesn't know what it means to be a Jew, or he never heard of the Torah, or he doesn't know anything about the purpose. So someone like that, it's going to be more leniency towards him. But one way or the other, he failed his life. Even if he doesn't get punished severely, or he gets some punishments for sure a person gets, even if he's a total ignorant in Judaism. Why? Because some things is required by common sense. For instance, if a Jew was born, I don't know, in Nebraska, never heard of Judaism over there. Besides Bruce Springsteen, nothing else he knows in his life. So what happened now? Somebody like that died one day, and they tell him, "Hey, Mr. or Mrs. Jew, what's the story with you?" So they're not going to ask him or her why he didn't keep Shabbat, why he didn't put tefillin, why he didn't eat strictly kosher. Because none of these things is required by common sense. You don't have a common sense obligation to keep Shabbat. Without the Torah, you would never know that Shabbat is a special day. You don't have any common sense to eat kosher. Why kosher, not kosher? What's the difference? But there are things that are required by common sense. You should not kill. You don't need to be religious to know that you're not allowed to kill people. Or you should not steal. Just without religion, a decent person understands that to steal is a bad thing? Yes. So if a person steals, it's subject to a punishment. Why? Because it's required by common sense. Jews, Goyim, everyone understands it. Respecting your parents, it's required by common sense. How can you be ungrateful to people that took care of you and raised you and paid for you so much, and you disrespect them? So that it's required by common sense. Loyalty, kindness, good manners, all these things is required by common sense. So even the Jews that are totally ignorant, meaning they never heard a word of Judaism in their life, they're already subject to many severe questions that would arise in the trial. Why you stole? Why you didn't respect people? Why your manners were horrible? Why you were an ungrateful human being? This is required by common sense before we even get into religion. So therefore, basically, no one is dismissed from a punishment. No one. However, everybody understands that there's a much, much different punishments between someone who knew Hashem, and he knew the Torah is real, and he went to yeshiva, and he decided to live like a goy. Someone like that is subject to a much, much more serious punishment than someone who never had a chance. That's clear. The Torah says it. It's called Tinok Shenishba, a baby that was captured by the goyim, meaning when he was a baby, they stole him, they kidnapped him, and he didn't know anything from his life. And one day he found out he's a Jew when he was an old man already. What is he going to do now? It was too late for him by then. But still is subject to the things that I mentioned before, which require by common sense. Now, what about the women? So the general purpose of a woman in the world, right away, obviously it's a little bit different than the men. There are general mitzvot that are mutual to men and women. Mutual. For instance, when it comes to the world, we have to believe in one God. It's one of the 13 principles. That's for men and women. We have to know that there will be days of Mashiach. That's one of the 13 principles of Judaism. We have to know one day there will be the resurrection of the dead after Mashiach comes for the righteous people that died. That's one of the 13 principles. We have to know that God rewards the righteous and punishes the wicked. That's another one of the 13 principles of Judaism. So there is a list of things. Moshe is the master of all prophets. There's a list of things that is men and women. It's the 13 principle applied to all people, men and women. However, there are mutual mitzvot also, like keeping Shabbat. Men and women, they have to keep Shabbat. Eating kosher, men and women. You know, a lot of the things that we do, it's men and women. But there is one more thing. Thank you. There's one more thing. There are unique purpose to a Jewish woman that is totally different than a man. What is the most important thing in the life of a Jewish woman? The most important by far, that if she does it, she's in a very good status. If she fell in that, she's in a very negative status. What is it? Who knows?
Creating a family.
How do your husband want? Sniut. Sniut. Who said sniut? One of my students. She heard it before. All right. So the idea is the most important. Remember what I'm giving you now. It's a tip for life. I'm sure you may hear it in the future again, or maybe you already heard about it. But don't ever forget what I'm telling you right now. The most important thing by far for a Jewish woman is modesty. Modesty is not only how you dress. Of course, it's very important to always dress skirts, below the knees, wide, not attached to the body, below the elbows. Nothing is open, nothing is clear, nothing is attached. And one day when you get married, you have to cover your head. And even if you go by the rabbis that allow wigs, it has to be a modest wig. All these things, it's a rules of modesty. Okay. But modesty with the clothing is one thing. There's other issues with modesty. For instance, chatting with men, talking too much to men, having friends, having a Facebook, email list, all kinds of things. WhatsApp, guys on your page, you put your pictures over there or on your Facebook page. Things like these are totally against the rules of modesty. Sometimes the girl is not yet in a level to understand it. So if you're far away from this level right now, at least you understand what the requirements are. Now you're aiming to get to there one day. But I'm telling you what's the ultimate perfect level of modesty. And before I'm going to finish the list, I want everyone to understand that the reason that modesty is the most important thing for women even comes before Shabbat, when Shabbat is the eternal covenant between us and Hashem. And a person that doesn't keep Shabbat, the Torah says, is actually cutting himself from Judaism. Shulchan Aruch says, Mechalel Shabbat, Areu kegoy lechol davar. Someone who doesn't keep Shabbat, in the eyes of Hashem, is count like a goy. It's not a joke. It's written in the Shulchan Aruch, in the Rambam, in the Gemara, in the Zohar, everywhere. No one disputed it. So even though it's such a horrible sin to be a mechalel Shabbat with a death penalty and the soul gets cut for eternity in the afterlife with such consequences of being mechalel Shabbos, it's still less than modesty for a woman. Why? Because when you break Shabbat, you have a very serious problem between you and Hashem. Very serious problem. But it's only between you and Hashem. It doesn't affect me, it doesn't affect her, it doesn't affect anyone else. It affects the world indirectly, meaning the Jewish nation suffer every time a Jew makes a sin. Because kol Yisrael arevim ze lazeh, all Jews are guarantors one for another. So meaning if a Jew makes a sin in Japan, it's still affecting every Jew in the world, indirectly. But that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking a direct effect doesn't have on me. If my friend is mechalel Shabbat, he's subject to his own punishment. It's nothing to do with me. But when a Jewish woman, she's not modest, she's basically gaining tons of sins by every man who looks at her every day. She walks in the street in New York, in Israel, especially in the summer days, with not modest clothes or provocative clothes, then automatically every man who looks at her is immediately one sin that goes to her account. And if it's going on and on and on, she keeps gaining more and more sins. That's called chote umachti. There's a difference between someone who is a sinner and someone is not only a sinner, is also influencing the public to commit sins. So for instance, by a man, if he's a DJ and mixed parties, he plays goyish music, guys and girls come, they touch each other, they dance together, they make sins later on, it all goes to his account. Because he's held responsible for all the sins that came out of his actions. Because in the Torah it's written that Hashem pays the person based on the fruits of his actions, whether it's good, whether it's bad. If you do something good, you open the yeshiva, and you died already. You totally left the. You already left the world, and the yeshiva is still going. And every year they make millions of mitzvot over there. Guys, they're in Gemara all day, and more and more and more. Even if you died, every Rosh Hashanah Hashem does the calculation, and he gives you extra reward for what you left in the world. Or the other way around. If you open a bar or a club in Tel Aviv, when guys come with girls and they do Chilulei Shabbat, they eat not kosher, they drink, drugs, all kinds of problems that take place in those places, the person that opened that place is held responsible for every little sin that is done there. It's not a joke. You can gain billions of sins a year doing basically nothing. Only one bad transaction, you open a club or a bar, and from now on, every bad thing that happens there against Hashem, everything you have to pay for. So obviously it's much better to open yeshiva than to open a bar. You open yeshiva, you gain a lot. You open a bar, sometimes costs you even more money, and you only gain negative punishments. Same thing with women. A woman is not modest. She walks in the street and attracts attention. If she's fully modest and people look at her, it's not her fault at all. Meaning she's not held responsible for anything. That's 100% their sins. They're looking to sin. But if she caused it by the way she dressed or by the way she behaves or by the way she talks, if she caused people to look at her by posting pictures online or all kinds of things like that, then every time someone has a thought about her, whether he's a Jew, whether he's a non-Jew, automatically she held responsible for that. And that's a very serious problem. So that's called chote umachti, committing sins and actually making other make sins against Hashem. Therefore, it's very important for a Jewish woman from a very young age that her parents would raise her in the right way, that she know that the most important thing is always to be modest from very young age. Because if you wait until she's 15, it's already a little bit difficult to change her habits. It has to be from a very young age. So that's very important purpose. You are here in the world not to fail in the laws of modesty. And by the way, if you look at the Torah, all the times that Hashem complimented a woman, whether it was Sarah and Rivka and Rachel, every time the Torah gave a compliment to a woman was always about modesty. But what happened to the chesed and the keeping Shabbos and all kinds of other things, it's not mentioned. It always comes down to one thing, modesty. Rivka, she goes, she covers with the camels, no one will look at her. When she sees Yitzchak, she covers herself with a scarf. Rachel, very modest. Leah, she wasn't 100%. Her daughter Dina went to the mall to see what the goyot are doing. The rest of the story is known to you. So the Torah wants to highlight what happened when a woman is not fully modest, what can happen. All these stories in the Torah, it's not stories for kindergarten. You know, you come and you listen to a story, you enjoy and you go home. Every story in the Torah comes to teach a very important principle for life. The principle is that Hashem doesn't like His daughters, the Jewish women, to behave not modestly. He doesn't like it. And obviously there are consequences. And I'm sure every one of you that sits here today and came all the way to Yerushalayim from Midrashia, that first of all means that you have a very high soul, that all of you are righteous, even though you're not perfect. No one is perfect, but you're righteous because someone that agreed to leave everything and to come and learn Torah, for sure is not a negative person. But the point is, if we already do it, let's do it right. Let's do it perfect. Let's do it the best way possible. And some of the things I'm telling you, maybe the institution will not dare to tell you. Why? Because they don't want to scare anyone. And again, nobody puts pressure on you. As long as you know what's the ultimate goal, you have a chance one day to achieve it. If you don't know, you will never feel that anything of what you're doing is wrong. Many religious girls don't see any problem by posting her pictures all over Facebook. That every guy that turns the page and accidentally see it, gum, and looks at your body, and he's thinking about you, and she doesn't feel what's going on. It can be thousands of guys, and then every time that something like this happens, it's something against Hashem. And most of the religious girl, or the modern Orthodox girl, that don't think it's any problem here to have internet and to put pictures, they're not understanding the consequences of something like that. And the question is, what did she really gain? Did she get any attention? If Tony and Vinny look at her in the internet, did she gain anything from it? Did he send her a letter? How beautiful you are. Anything happened to her? Did she gain anything in her life? Mm-hmm. Nothing. If it's face to face, at least she gets attention. Why people do certain things? They dress in a certain way. They talk in a certain way. Because they want to get attention, they want to be loved, they want to be the best, or everyone with his ideas. But online, it's really foolish. Even if the guy will write to her a few nice words, how exactly she gained from it? Only lose. You can only lose. You cannot gain from it. So that's where the Satan, the Yetzer Hara, is a genius. He makes you unaware of these things. And in a moment, a person, Chas v'Shalom, can lose everything. One bad transaction online or on a phone with a guy or anything like that, you lose control over it. There is one girl here in Israel, she almost became the Miss Beauty of Israel. In the contest, she almost won. Very pretty girl. She's in the Israeli army. She's still a soldier. Baruch Hashem, she listened to my lectures online. Her sister in America, she already became Baal Tshuva. She gave her my lecture, she started to listen, she became religious now. You had to see how she's crying to me on the phone that now her picture is all over. And she called the people and asked them to remove it. Nobody cares, bichlal. You have no control over it. Women, they have pictures when they're not modest in the younger age, sometimes in a very not modest way. And one day they become religious and they have religious kids. They put their kids in the best yeshivot. And accidentally, one day, someone will show the kids, look at your mother with a bathing suit all over the internet. You know what a disaster is this? Sometimes a 1 second mistake can cost you 20 years of suffering. Not to talk about the consequences in Shamayim. I'm not even getting to that. Here in this world, same thing movie stars. All these movie stars, when they're young, they do all kinds of things in movies. Then one day they grow up, they have a husband and children. And everyone in the class make fun. Look at your mother in a movie. Imagine the kids, how they have to feel when they show them that their mother, a married woman, she acting in the movies, and I don't have to tell you what they do in the movies. Girls have to know Hashem sone zima, Elohim sone zima. The biggest tragedies in the Jewish nation came from lack of modesty between men and women. In the Torah you can see epidemics. 3,000 died, 24,000 people died. Just in case you didn't know, since Israel became a state 70 years ago until now, about 24,000 soldiers died in all the wars and all the activity of the Israeli army. In one lack of modesty incident in the Torah, 24,000 Jews died. In one incident, they went to Bnot Moab and all the things that happens in the Torah. A massive tragedy. Massive. Why? Elohim sonezim Hashem is an ultimate purity of modesty. You understand? He allowed certain things, but between husband and wife. But anything else, it's very, very big sin. So please pay attention from now on, from the rest of your life, that it's not a joke. It's not, okay, another mitzvah. No, no, no. If you go one day on the street not modest, it's worse than eating pork a million times. And I'm sure if they give you pork to eat, you won't dare to eat it, right? Somebody will put you a steak from pig, pork. Would you eat it?
No.
What happened if you offer you $100 to eat it?
No.
$1,000?
No.
$10,000?
Okay.
At least somebody is honest here.
$10,000
to eat pork.
Money, though.
But let me ask you a question. Let's say you eat pork and you got $10,000. What do you think will happen next?
I just go crazy.
No, what do you think will happen next? Do you think there is a chance ever to benefit by going against Hashem?
No.
I'll ask the question in a different way. Do you think someone in history ever lost by listening to Hashem? Who rewards and punishes in the world? Only Hashem, right? No one can do anything to you unless Hashem agree. Right? Okay. So now, if Hashem says in the Torah, I'm expecting you to pass the test, I want you to be righteous, I want you to be modest, I want you to keep Shabbat, I want you to eat strictly kosher, I don't want you to open your business on Shabbos. And then Hashem said to a person, if you're going to listen to me and follow my Torah and my mitzvot, I will reward you endlessly. I will reward you in your end. I will benefit you and your children after you for eternity. This is all verses in the Torah. Now imagine a guy say, Rabbi, it's hard for me to close the business on Shabbat. It's $3,000 business. Every day I make $1,000. Come Shabbat, it's a weekend, New York, I make $3,000 profit. You're asking me now to close four Shabbos a month, it's $12,000 reduction from my business. Basically, you're killing my business. I cannot do it, I'm sorry. I myself don't break Shabbat, but I cannot close my store. So basically, this person's saying, if I'm going to listen to Hashem and close my business on Shabbat, and instead of being in a store, I will be in a synagogue or in a yeshiva, because of that, I'm going to lose money. If somebody think like that, is nothing but an infidel, is a kofer. He's not a believer in Hashem. He doesn't believe in the 13th principle of Judaism that Hashem reward the righteous and punish the wicked. Based on his theory, Hashem punish the righteous for sacrificing money, for sacrificing their will to Hashem's will, for forcing themselves to close the business, or a girl that has very, very high yetzer hara to show her body in the street, and she fights with her evil inclination, and she dresses very modest, and she behaves very modest, even though her personality pushing her towards negative things, but she keeps fighting herself not to do the bad things in the eyes of Hashem. And then she thinks, because I'm being righteous, I'm going to pay a price and I'm going to suffer. How can it be? Even between men to men, if you have a worker and he gives his heart for the business, he comes early, he leaves late, he never asks for raise, he never asks extra for staying longer, he works so hard, he's such an honest guy. Is it possible that after you have such an employee, you will hurt him more than all the other bad employees? Or it's more logical that you will benefit him as much as you can? Which one of the two is more logical?
Benefit.
benefit him. Do you know one person in the world that he has a worker like this, and he, instead of benefiting him, is going to go against him and torture him? Do you know any person like this? Jew, Arab, Chinese, Japanese? Do you think anyone in the world will do such thing?
No.
So basically what you're saying, that Hashem is worse than the worst human being on earth. If people won't do it, how do you even think that it's possible that Hashem will do such thing? That someone that gives so much to keep Shabbat, and so much to dress modest, and so much not to make sins with the guys, and all the things that girls are doing in your age, because of that you're going to pay a price and to lose? How can it be to think like that? If somebody here, sitting here today, is even thinking like that, let me give you a smack and wake you up from your dream and remind you that maybe you think you're religious, but you're still not religious. Because religion is not only to be a robot that keeps mitzvot. Religion means I listen to Hashem, and there is no chance whatsoever that I will ever lose from doing it. It's impossible. I can only gain. Now I know what you're thinking. Wait a minute, Rabbi, it's a beautiful speech, but in reality, I am losing. Right? My friends are going to make scenes. They travel. They have all kinds of boyfriends. Who knows what? And I am a Rebbetzin, and I'm giving up a lot of things. So why you say I'm not losing? When I say you're not losing, I don't mean momentarily. The reaction of Hashem to our actions is not instant. It's not immediate reaction. Whether it's a reward, whether it's a punishment, it never comes right away. Very rarely Hashem reacts immediately to what we do. Usually when a person makes a sin today, he can get punished 30 years later, or 10 years later, or a month later. Most likely it will never be right away. The opposite, when a person goes to rob a store and to steal money, and he prays and read Tehillim that Hashem will help him not to get caught, what do you think Hashem is doing? He's helping him. He's helping him to go steal. Who gives him oxygen? Hashem. Who gives him energy to walk? Hashem. Hashem could have stopped his heart, get a heart attack. Hashem could have made him faint. Why Hashem help him to go rob a place? It's against the Torah. That he should punish him later on. But why? Because there's a rule in the Torah. I put you here in a test. I do not interfere with your free choice. Whatever you choose, that's what you're going to do. I won't stop you. I won't push you to do good. I won't push you to do bad. I won't prevent you from doing bad. I will never prevent you from doing good. I will help you in everything you want me to help you. You choose to do good, I will help you. You choose to do bad, I will also help you, equally. I help the righteous, I help the wicked. I give oxygen to the righteous, I give oxygen to the wicked. Why is it? In the end, everyone comes in front of me for a trial. That's when we're gonna decide who gets what. But until then, I do not interfere with your choices. You want to marry a goy? Go ahead, marry a goy. It's your choices. You want to be righteous? Go ahead, be righteous. In the end, everything will be displayed on the screen, every moment of your life, whether you did good, whether you did bad. We'll analyze everything, and we'll decide where to send you, based on what you did. Then you're going to ask, why did you allow me to be Mechalel Shabbos? It's not fair. Why did you keep me alive? It would be better off I will die in my 20s. Why did I live to 80 now that I have to pay for so many sins? Why? The answer would be, Bederech she'adam rotze lilech molichim oto. In a way that a person chooses, the path that a person chooses, Hashem, he's walking him through that path. Whether it's a good path, whether it's a bad one. So let's not forget that Hashem doesn't respond instantly. So when you steal and you get away with that, you did not get away with that. It's registered in the book of God. Ayin roa ve'ozen shoma'at ve'chol ma'asecha ba'sefer nichtavim. There's an eye who watch over you. There's an ear who listens to you. And everything you do, it's recorded in the book of God. Why? What for? The answer, because in the end, we will all be analyzed. So let's go back to the beginning. Modesty, most important purpose for a woman's life. The way you behave from now until you get married, first of all, will determine what husband you're going to have. If you're going to be extra righteous and modest and clean and not doing all kinds of bad things, then Hashem see that you're worthy enough to be with a very high soul, a great tzaddik guy, that watch his eyes, that will be very honest and very modest and very loyal to you and will treat you always nice, will never yell at you, will never be violent with you, will never cheat, will not do horrible things like many men do out there. Because the Gemara say, Mezavgim lo la'adam zivug lefi ma'asav. This is Gemara in Masechet Sotah, the first page. The Gemara says, you get your zivug, your soulmate, based on your own actions. You're acting modest, you're going to get a modest guy. You have strong devotion to Hashem, you're very high in emunah, you're very spiritual, you're going to get the greatest guy in the yeshiva. You want to be the girls on the street, without going into details, you're going to get a guy like that. And then you're going to see how horrible life has become. We are eating today what we cooked yesterday. Remember this. Nothing happened by coincidence. There's no such thing coincidence. Even when a leaf falls from a tree, if it will fall right here, or it will fall right here, it's a decision of Hashem. Who cares? Why does it matter if the leaf fell here or it fell over here? Does it make a difference in the world? Why Hashem have to interfere in every little tiny detail? If a little piece of styrofoam fell from the ceiling on the floor now, does it make a difference in the world? So now there's a crack here. Does it make any difference in the world? Believe it or not, it can make big differences in the world. When a leaf falls over here, an hour later, a carriage walks by, and the leaf stick to the wheel, and it goes about 2 miles, and then it gets dry because it was raining. Now it got dry, it falls, and a bird comes, and the birds eat it, and because of that, the bird does not die. Changing, it's affecting the whole world. Even things that look totally not relevant are very relevant. Every word you say to a person changes the entire world. It's called, in science, the butterfly effect. The butterfly here in Yerushalayim is moving his wings now. It's affecting people in China. Few days later, one thing leads to another. We don't see it. I give you one example. You spoke Lashon Hara about your friend in the internet. You wrote a bad comment about her. And then you forgot about it. That's 2-3 days later. You're not as angry anymore. You forgot about the incident. And you move on with your life like nothing happened. But it's not true. Not only a lot has happened, it will happen in the next 20 years also, every day. It will never stop. Why? 200 people read it. So now they know this girl, Miriam, she has this problem that you exposed her in the internet. So 200 people knows about it. And people talk, so they told another 500 people, who told another 5,000 people. And one day, this girl Miriam, she is dating a guy. And the family of the guy is beginning to do a check on her. And then they call somebody and he say, oh, you know, she has this problem. I heard once this. And everyone add to the story because people are not always precise in the details. So they make it usually worse. Everyone add something to the story. And you ruin her shidduch. In the end, they decided not to take her. And it was all a lie. Moment of anger, you publish something against her, or you told 2-3 girls on the street, and that was the end of it. And what happened later? 2 years later, when she was supposed to marry to a great guy, and she was supposed to have 8 wonderful souls coming to the world, you actually prevented it. So now, you actually interfere with the will of Hashem. Hashem wanted this girl to marry this guy very badly. It's very, very good combination, and Hashem had great plans for them. And you, in one sin that you made that took exactly a second, you actually interfere with that, and you made a destruction in Hashem's plan. You think you can get away with that? Somebody came to the Chafetz Chaim, he said, I spoke a lot of Lashon Hara. I spoke a lot of gossip. I want to fix it. I realize how horrible it is. Chafetz Chaim said to him, come, I'll show you how to fix it. He took a pillow with feathers, and he went up to the roof, and he said to him, hit the pillow as hard as you can. And the feathers started to fly all over, and the Chafetz Chaim said, you want to fix it? Go collect all the feathers now. So how can I collect them? They fly all over. How I mean, it's not possible. Chafetz Chaim said, this is how it is to fix Lashon Hara. This is how hard it is. Basically, it's impossible. So why are we praying to Hashem for Mechila, for Lashon Hara? There's no way to fix it. Well, it's the same thing when you murder a person. There's no way to bring him back to life, but you're still praying to Hashem to forgive you for the sin, right? So and when we repent, when we do tshuva, don't think that because we do tshuva, we actually fix the situation. No, it's called me'uvat lo yuchal litkon. Me'uvat means something that was already smashed, was totally destroyed, can never be fixed. So we're only begging not to fix the situation. The world will never be the same after the sins we made. We're only begging Hashem to delete the punishment and the consequences, the negative consequences that we are subject to get. That's it. And Hashem can have mercy on us because, you see, we stopped and we repent, we regret, we're ashamed. And he takes away the punishment from the file. But the consequences of our actions remain forever. I'll give you an example. You see this glass over here, all these glasses, they're very expensive, probably hundreds of dollars each. If I take a stone now and I throw it and I smash the glass, $200 damage. Now the owner of the place come to me and say, what are you doing? I say, I don't know, I went crazy. I'm so embarrassed. I'm sorry, please forgive me. I'm ashamed. He said to me, all right, put it together, I'll forgive you. So how can I put it together? It's 1,000 pieces of glass on the floor. So it's your problem, not mine. I want the glass the way it was 2 minutes ago. If not, I don't forgive you. There's any way to fix it? Everybody understands there's no way to fix it, right? So what's the alternative? The alternative is to beg the owner of the place for forgiveness. Please forgive me. I'll never do it again. Have mercy on me. If he has a good heart, he say, okay, listen, you fool. Just go. I forgive you. Goodbye. And he forgave me. I got away with the punishment. This is basically tshuva, what it is. That's the maximum we can get. Here in this world, you can go and buy a new one and install it. Fine. But in life, you killed someone, you cannot bring him to life. You ruined someone's reputation in the internet, you cannot fix it. That's it. There's no way to fix it. There's no way. It's impossible. Technically, there's no way to do it. You walked in the street 2, 3, 4, 5 years with very provocative clothes, very provocative, not modest behaving. Now you became Baruch Hashem a Rebbitzin. But what about the 5 years? There's thousands of guys and millions of thoughts and who knows what happened in the world and how many husbands and wives fought because of you and how many people are looking at you on the internet. Now, how are you going to fix it now? The answer, there's no way to fix it. There's billions of sins out there. There's no way to fix it. The only way is that when Hashem is convinced that you're not going to do it ever again, slowly, slowly you will delete this from your file. Not that you fixed it. The damage is done and continue to travel. But Hashem will have mercy on you. This is what the Torah say. Veshavta ad Hashem Elokecha, veshamata bekolo. You return all the way to your God and you listen to Him. Veshav Hashem Elokecha verichamecha. And Hashem will return from His anger towards you and will have mercy on you. But it doesn't mean that you fix the situation. Of course not. It now means that Hashem has mercy on you and accept you back and give you another chance. This is what tshuva is. We got lucky that Hashem gave us this opportunity to repent. In a normal world today, there's no time to repent. If you didn't pay 20 years the electric bill, you cannot come to the judge and say, dear judge, I know I owe $20 million to the electric company because they forgot to bill me for the last 20 years. But I promise from now on that I will not repeat that. From now on, I'm going to start paying my electric bill. The judge will say, take him to a psychiatric evaluation. It's not normal. 20 years he didn't pay, now he tells me from now on I'm going to start paying. What about the 20 years? You must pay for the 20 years, or you go to jail. By Hashem, it's not like that. Hashem, okay, say, let's see if from now on you're paying. Let's see if you're not going to repeat what you used to do. And this is what changed the entire life of a person. Bezrat Hashem, you should know, it pays to work hard now. Now it's a critical age for you. After you get married, it will be impossible to fix some things. That's it, you're married. What are you going to do? Get divorced? It's not a solution usually. Before you get married, be smart. If you want to be righteous after you get married, of course, it's never late as long as you're alive, but the consequences are already here. You won't be able to fix it. If now you'll be righteous in the next year, two or three, I promise you, I give you my word, you're going to see it in the future husband you're going to have, that it paid big time for you. If you want to be righteous in 3-4 years from now, after you met someone and now you want to be righteous, first of all, most likely you won't agree. I didn't marry you like this, I'm sorry. I'm not interested you cover your head. I'm not interested you dress like this. That's not how I met you. And then his parents, and then he this, and all kinds of obstacles. Now you can do it. You're free. You're independent. You're alone. Nobody can tell you what to do. You still don't have the pressure of the other side. So if you are already really religious without being fake, really, then Hashem knows that you deserve someone that is just as good as you. But if you fake, Hashem will give you another faker. What do you think? Min matzah et mino. It's a rule. Mezavgim lo la'adam zivug lefi ma'asav. So isn't it a shame to come all the way to the Holy Land, to the holiest place in the world, sitting here on a mountain, close to Hashem? This is the gate to heaven, right here. That's what Yaakov Avinu had a dream, right here, few kilometers away here. It's the holiest place on earth. You're sitting here, I'm sure your parents pay a lot of money for sending you here. So much sacrifice and efforts, and in the end, not to do it right? Chaval. I want to tell you, in life, when people fail, not everyone feels the same pain. I'll give you an example of what I mean. There is a king, and he has 1,000 soldiers. And the king says, I have to leave now. I don't know when I'll be back. Today, tomorrow, next day. It's the pen. I want all of you to stand ready. Don't sit. If you sit, it's against my instructions. So all the soldiers stood online. 1,000 soldiers waiting for the king. The king left. An hour later, one soldier is already lazy, doesn't want to be standing, he sits down. Another hour, another 3 sits down. Another hour, another 10 sits down. Every hour, a few more soldiers are sitting down. Already the next day, 24 hours, they're standing, they're already fainting. By now, only 100 soldiers are still standing. The second day began. 5 hours later, only 10 soldiers are standing. Another hour or two soldiers are standing. Another 8 sat down. And the king walked in. The king just walked in. And he see 2 soldiers are standing, 998 are sitting. He take the 2 soldiers, give them a huge reward. Now all the 998 soldiers, who is going to eat his heart the most? Huh? The last 8. They just sat down 2 minutes before he walked in. The one that sat down an hour later yesterday is feeling bad. I wish I would stand all this time and get the reward. But at least he's thinking, at least I wasn't standing 24 hours for it. The one that stood 24 hours and 2 minutes before the king walked in, he's killing himself. What a fool I am. Another 5 minutes and I'll be a billionaire. Why did I tell you this parable, this mashal? Because all of you are in this situation right now. You already traveled a lot. You became more religious. You came all the way here. Over here is supposed to be even better and better and higher to get already much close to the well. And in the end, not to drink. It's a billion times worse than some of your friends back there that are not even Shomer Shabbos and they don't care about the religion and nothing. Well, they do nothing from day one. They get what they deserve in the end and that's it. But you that already came so close, just reach your arm and grab, and not to grab in the end, when we leave this world, it's going to be a disaster. So, wow, I was already there, I was already sitting in Midrashia. Another year of efforts, I will get the right guy and have a wonderful life and a marriage and wonderful children. And then when we die, we go to the highest place in Olam Haba. I was a moment from it, and then I kicked the bucket, and I went back, and Hashem Yirachem, what happened from then on? And I see it 23 years happening to people, in yeshivot and in midrashiot. They go. Then they begin to go down and they lose everything. Be careful not to let the Yetzer Hara trap you. Take advantage on every moment here. Life is not a picnic. There's a lot of responsibilities. Every day over here is a big mitzvah for you. Even though women are not obligated to learn Torah like a man, but when they learn, they get a reward, and a big one, because it's a huge reward for it. Plus, it will help you in the future. When you have children, you're going to see the results of what you're doing here today, later on in your life. You may not see the whole picture yet, but you will see how it's going to affect you tremendously, because Hashem is happy from what you're doing, and He will reward you for that. In this world and in the next world. Any questions before we finish? Everyone is in shock? Beautiful. Who is not in shock? You're not in shock, though. You're used to it. You heard that, right? Anyone here is not in shock? Baruch Hashem, everyone is normal here. You must be shocked. That's the whole purpose of this talk. When you treat a patient, you have to treat him with shock. You know, there's a tipul b'shok. In Israel, they call it like that. Rashi says, doctor that say to his patients, don't eat cold and don't be in a cold place, maybe you get sick. And there's a doctor who say the same thing, but he add one more sentence. Don't eat cold and don't be in a cold place that you won't get sick like Reuven who did it and died. Which one of the two doctors deserve to be a doctor, Rashi asked? Only the second. The first one who didn't tell him like Reuven that did it and died is a worthless doctor. Why? Because the doctor is not enough just to fix the physical problem in a body. You have to protect in the mind of a person an option that this person will not follow the right direction and he will die eventually. You have to wake that, to trigger it in his mind. Same thing in religion, life of eternity. If people understand there is Hashem, there is a Torah, there is a purpose, and they, God forbid, may go off the derech, somebody has to give them a few smacks, wake them up before it happens, and save them for eternity. So that's a very positive thing. So no questions, Baruch Hashem. Any questions you have in the future, you can email me, rabbimizrachi@gmail.com. I usually answer a large portion of my emails. Thank you very much. I wish every one of you atzlacha and you see results in your learning and Bezrat Hashem, the best shiduchim when the time comes. Amen. To establish a good, kosher, religious, amazing home. Amen. To bring nachat to your parents and to your teachers. Thank you very much. Shavua tov.